You're live here with coverage of the 91st Giro d'Italia. Live on Eurosport, it's May the 16th. We're on stage 780 kilometres today, and it's the first mountaintops finish at Pesco Costanzo. Right in the centre of Italy today. Giovanni Visconti, the Italian champion, is the current leader in this year's Giro d'Italia. Taking over the pink jersey yesterday from the shoulders of Franco Pellizzotti, who is one of a group of 11 riders who escaped early in the day. This is how it happened. Priamo, Perez, Trusoff, Martin, Zyglinski, Nardello, Govazzi, Visconti, Baxted, Rus, and Jason McCartney all went away. The best placed on GC was German Matthias Rus. Just behind him was Giovanni Visconti, 13 seconds down on Rus's time. Meanwhile, in this shortened stage, they let the 11 breakaway riders get an enormous advantage of 15 minutes and 50 seconds by 160 kilometers. Franco Pellizzotti, knowing that the jersey was going to go from his shoulders. Eventually, towards the end, it was Priamo who made the attack, followed by Perez. And then finally, Magnus Baxted trying to get across to those two, Priamo and Perez, using his powerful time trying style, but it was always going to be a difficult task for Magnus Baxted with an uphill finish. Priamo, who's won two stages in the presidential tour of Turkey already this year, powering away from Alain Perez to take victory here in the Giro d'Italia for CFS Group Navigare. Perez had to be content with second place only. Behind, though, this is what really counted. Visconti had taken some bonuses on the road, which put him within striking distance of Rus and, of course, the pink jersey. That's why Visconti is looking over his shoulder, because he's going for it as fast as possible. Matthias Rus trying to stay in touch, but losing an extra few seconds to Giovanni Visconti. It was enough for Visconti to take over the pink jersey. Meanwhile, it was Daniele Bonatti leading the pack home at 11 minutes. He wanted the points, of course, for the Ciclamino jersey. So, the Italian national champion Visconti goes into pink. But it may be short-lived, because today might be completely different for him. Visconti and Rus given the same time now on the overall standings. But because Visconti was in a better position on the stage itself, he takes over pink. Pellizzotti is now down in seventh place, 9 minutes down on Giovanni Visconti. Di Luca is at 7 seconds behind Pellizzotti. Then Nibali, Savoldelli, Colodin, Contador, Rico, Simoni, Leipheimer, Menchov and Ruhano in there as well. We've not seen anything of him so far. We may see something of him today, you never know. This is what it looks like today. Winding, circuitous route around into the middle of the Italian peninsula, finishing at Pesco Costanzo. 15 points up for grabs in the mountains classification. 20 seconds, of course, at the top of the mountain if you're first over the line. The direction of the wind, southwesterly, as you can see, just 11 kilometers an hour, 15 degrees the temperature. A lot of arm warmers out today. And you can see up in the distance, on the Apennines, the top of the mountain still covered in snow. And a lot of the climbs that we will be facing in the last week of this year, Giro d'Italia, as of today, still with a lot of snow on them. This is the head of the race then. There are a group of seven away with 32 other riders trying to chase them down. The other 32 riders we won't all name right now, but they are 3 minutes and 45 seconds down on these seven riders. Further back is the peloton at 6:35 at the moment. That is Vasily Kirienka. He started the attacks today after just 6 kilometers, was soon brought back in by the peloton, but he had another go, went away again. He's taken a whole load of riders with him. They are, as you've seen, Kirienko has just gone through. Emanuele Sella, you can see in your shot, has just gone through for the CSF Navigare squad in the green there. That is Bozioso, also Baliani, Felix Cardenas, and Juan Horach are in here. This is how the competition for the overall best climber stands at the moment with Emanuele Seller on 15 points ahead of Pietro Poli on 5, Felix Cardenas on 5, Leverda on 3 loosely, and Verbrugge also on 3. This is the third category, Velika di Macarona, after 118 kilometres. Seller wrapping up the points there. And Baliani getting in there as well to try and steal as many points as possible. Felix Cardenas second. So those two already laying down their markers as to what competition they're going for. In terms of overall standing and the general classification, the best placed man is Felix Cardenas. Or sorry, Gabriel Bocioso is the best placed man at 10.01. Then Felix Cardenas at 10.07. Everybody is over 10 minutes. The worst placed man on GC in the break is Vasily Kirienka at 27.39. So maybe the breakaway is destined to succeed today, but you don't know because we've really only just got over the very first mountain of the day now. Let's just go through those lead riders again. Juan Arach of Case de Pagna, Felix Cardenas of Barlo World, Fortunato Baliani and Emanuele Seller, both of CSF Navigare, Simon Spilak of Lampre, Gabriele Bozioso of LPR, and Vasily Kirienko. There is Baliani in the front of your shot here in the green with the orange helmet. And Baliani always likes to go out on these long mountain attacks, especially in the early part of the race in the Giro d'Italia. We've seen him in the last two or three years doing something similar. This is Bozioso for LPR, Vasily Kirienka, the man who hit the deck recently and brought down poor old Brad McGee. Felix Cardenas there, customary white specs. Little Emanuele Seller. Seller, the sort of undisputed star of CSF Navigare, really. And Spilak. See if another 32 riders get up to this lap, or are we going to see the big guns firing today?
Well, it's certainly a different day, different riders out front, and you know, when you look at the number of riders up the road here, it's a huge number, 32 in this group chasing our seven leaders, and the gap, as we see, over 6 minutes back to the bunch. So, you know, a lot of teams represented up and some good riders, because when you look through the names of riders out there, certainly in with a very good chance at the end of this stage to take a victory, and certainly some of the smaller teams. So the question is, who's going to take up the chase from behind? But certainly, I think, you know, there's going to be some of the big teams or the big favourites going to take it up, but where and when is the big question. So it's, you know, it's going to be another day who's going to take control of the race here, because, you know, with the yellow jersey, with the quick step, you know, I don't think they're going to really control it, because, you know, they're not going to hold on to the jersey today. It's going to be major difficulty for Visconti to hold on to his leader's jersey. So I think it will be some of the favours for the end of the race to win the race outright, but maybe Sonia Duval, once again we will see them. So it's certainly an interesting one, and so many riders up the road. It's been very fast and a lot of attacking, like, to get this many riders away, it's not certainly easy.
No, not at all. Spilak and Juan Horach, the reason they're not in your shot is they now have 25 seconds, as you saw, to make up on their former breakaway partners. So Baliani, Cardenas, Kirienka, Seller and De Bozioso just pulling away from Spilak and Horach by 25 seconds. 2:45 now back to the group of 32 riders. We'll try and bring you as many of those names as possible, and then a further 2 minutes back to the main pelotons. So about a 5 minute gap between our main breakaway riders and the peloton. Is Bozioso at the front for LPR. Some of the riders chasing, we have over race radio, Daniele Pietropoli will want to be doing that because he needs to try and accumulate some more points in the mountains, and things are beginning to break up behind already. Nicolas Russo of AG2R Le Mondial, Maxim Miglinski of Astana, Azan Bazaev, Steve Cummings from Barlow World, Pablo Lastras from Case de Pagne, Jose Rujano of Case de Pagne, Juan Huger from Cofidis, Savini of CFS Group Navigare, Mikel Iratha of Euskaltel Escari, Alain Deleuze also of Euskaltel, Lilian Jégou from Francis Dujour, and Roslan Ivanov. Those are the ones we managed to spot or hear on race radio so far. And already things are beginning to split up into twos and threes, Sean. And this only on the first real climb of the day.
Yes, well, of course, on the real climb of the day, the first real climb of the day, it's there's some difficult climbs today. We're talking about the finish being a difficult one, but that's, you know, really only a number of kilometres up the finish. It's before that we have quite a few climbs to get over today, so I think... there's another climb of 9.2 kilometres, and the finish, of course, is really only a 3 kilometre. But from the climb of 9 kilometres, as I say, which is about 6.5%, you know, it drags on to the finish. It doesn't really go down for a long time at all. There's a little bit of descending, but then, you know, it's up and down, undulating until the final climb. So we could see in that second last climb of the day, that's where all the action we could see coming.
Let's just run through those climbs today. The first we have already seen this group go over, and the rest of the peloton are going over as well. That is the Valico di Macarona, coming after 118 kilometres, just over 3.5K in length, the third category climb. Then we move on to the Rionero Sanitico. And the Sanitico first category climb, very difficult, and that's the long one, 9.4K. Then there's a sprint in between, which comes after 142 kilometres. Then the Pietra Nesseri, which is a second category climb after 166.5 kilometres. And finally finishing off at Pesco Costanzo, which is just under 3 kilometres, but it's going to be a nasty little kick up, especially having had to go over the Pietra Nesseri first. There is the profile of the course today. There's the first of the climbs, Macarona. They are now climbing the Rionero Sanitico. This is the very long first category climb. It's a fairly steady climb, but not easy. And being made a first category climb just because of its length and the way it's slotted into this profile. Well, it started off at about 15 degrees today, but certainly the temperature's gone up here in the Giro d'Italia. And the real climbing starts today. Giovanni Visconti taking the jersey yesterday, Sean. Some debate, certainly amongst our German colleagues. they were convinced that Matthias Ross should be in the pink. That's unsurprising. They wanted to make sure they do that, but they've been given the same time, and it all comes down to placings in stages.
Yes, well, of course, confusion and of the confusion yesterday at the finish with Visconti taking the bunny.
times. But Visconti, of course, taking extra seconds out on the road, and that helping him when he got about 4 or 5 seconds over Mateus Ross at the final of yesterday's stage. There's Felix Cardenas. Cardenas, a winner of stages in the Tour de France and the Tour of Italy, I seem to remember, but out today again. He's a real mountain goat, is Cardenas. He promised an awful lot, didn't he, Sean, at one time, Felix Cardenas, and never has really quite delivered on it.
Well, of course, in the Tour of Italy, he seemed to have, put up good performances. But again, I think, he goes for the moments and he chooses his days to go on the break. And here we are once again today, an opportunity, a mountaintop finish and a very difficult day. We haven't, really seen a lot of those riders, as I say, up till now. And today is the day where they can get out there and, go for a stage victory. And that's the style of parkour today. The other days, of course, maybe not the finish, not difficult enough, and a bit too much, fighting for position before we get to the final climbs, which we had the last number of stages finishing at the top of a hill, but only 2 or 3 Ks of a climb. Not a difficult day enough for those guys, but they can pull off mountainous stages, but for the general classmen, sometimes they suffer a bit. So they're good climbers, but limited to in the general classmen, really.
Just probably need to correct myself, I think. Thinking back on it, I'm not sure that he has won a stage in the Tour de France. He certainly won one in the Tour of Spain. Nice to see on the front, an illustration of what we were talking about the other day about wheels. Very good. When you see the chap from Sonia Deval in the yellow and black at the front, you'll see he's got an aluminium rim on the front, carbon on the back. And that certainly helps with the braking. There is your pink jersey, the Italian national champion, wearing the leader's jersey now of Giovanni Visconti, and already suffering a bit today. It's going to be very difficult for him to hang on to that today, and I don't really think, if I was in his position, Sean, I wouldn't think I'd be too worried if it slipped off my shoulders at this early stage.
No, certainly not, and I think he was very happy with the jersey yesterday, and reading some of the interviews, he said it was just a great day to take the leader's jersey. And of course, for an Italian, it's majorly important to take the race leadership in your national tour, and certainly the occasion was, the timing was pretty fine, because of course yesterday's stage was one of the last chances. I think today he will lose a bit of time on this the final run in.
And the interesting thing will be to see how well some of the big favourites are going, how well Simone is going. We saw him come to the front yesterday of the peloton when they were flying in towards the finish yesterday. It's the first time we've seen him at all. It'll be interesting to see how De Luca is looking. He's been up towards the front of the first 2 or 3 stages, but not really pulled anything off yet. He couldn't out-sprint Riccardo Rico. That's another man. We'll have to see how he's recovering from his hand injury. And, of course, Maurizio Sola, the Colombian rider. 50K then to the finish. These are your 5 men out of the front. Vasily Kirienko in the yellow for Tinkoff. Then there are 2 CFS Navigari riders, the smaller of the two being Emanuele Sella, Fortunato Baliani being the other rider. They are the 2 in green.
the effect when you come back from the altitude. And you know, I was back and it was a couple of days later for the Tour of Lombardy, so you know, the season was over, I suppose, really, when the effect from the altitude kicks in.
Some great Colombian riders in the past, of course, Lucho Herrera and Fabio Parra. My favourite rider, as I've said it before, Fabio Parra always looked to me as like a boxer, although he'd been, or rather been hit in the face with a shovel. But terrific rider, just I love watching him. There was a very interesting magazine article last year, sometime during the Tour de France, when Solar was out ahead in the King of the Mountains competition, published by L'Équipe, and it looked back at where all these guys were now and what they were doing for a living, and I'll dig it out, because some of the great heroes of Colombian cycling doing all sorts of different jobs now. One owns a market stall, for example. I think one deals in the bike industry, one's a builder. They're doing all sorts of things that you wouldn't expect. One, in fact, is, I think it is Fabio, actually. Fabio Parra is an academic. He's at a university, if I remember rightly. I could be wrong, but I'll have a look at it. But the man who looked physically least likely to be the academic turned out to be the one who's has double degrees and works now at a university. I seem to remember, I may have got that wrong, confused it with one of the other riders, but I'll look that out for you. Emanuele Silla is the man at the front of shot there, number 61 for CFS Navigare, a real mountain goat, and he's got Felix Cardenas, the Colombian, in the red of Barlowell, just behind him. And Fortunato Baliani, the second of the CFS Navigare men in the break there also. And Sella going up towards the GPM, taking the points ahead of Cardenas. So, an extra 10 points for Sella. To add to his 15, he'll move on to 25, taking a nice, comfortable lead there. Cardenas taking 6.
And they're a team which probably have, you know, much more climbers than anything else in the team, and today is the day where they're going to shine, and they're certainly, you know, out there in force and push put plenty of men up the road, and it's the way to do it, because the situation they're in here, if, you know, they can continue on working well and they hold on to the finish, well, you have two cars to play, which is always a great advantage, especially in a mountain finish, because if one rider for some reason he's a normally a good climber, but he might be a bit on an off day, the other one maybe, you know, on his real good day, well then you have a great chance of getting a stage victory for the team.
That's the confirmation then. Sella, Cardenas, Baliani. This is the second group on the road now, including Simon Spilak, who was in the lead group, has dropped back. The big tall Belgian on the left-hand side in the Lotto gear is Jürgen van den Broek. And I think I could see Suetsu in there from High Road. Juan Manuel Garate definitely in there. Van den Broek can climb very well. And the last rider, not sure who that was. Schmidt can climb well. We've seen it regularly in the Giro d'Italia. Garate, we know, is an excellent climber. Suetsu, not so much a climber, not known as a climber, but then they go over the top at 154. Schmidt, Suetsu, van den Broek, Garate. I'm sure I saw another rider behind somewhere, but those are the four who've gone over the top now. And I get a chance for a bit of coke. Suetsu was, you remember, last time we saw him was when he was suffering in the team time trial. There is Juan Raj, and it looks like Maurizio Ardila going over the top. And that looks like a Fimpkin to me from Quickstep, and he is absolutely powering on to get up with Ardila and Raj. That then will be Simon Spillack, who has been passed. So a lot of riders now coming across quite quickly, Sean, and bridging the gap and trying to get across to the front five.
Yes, well, it's, of course, there's a bit of a battle in that group of 32. There's going to be, you know, some action, and there's certainly a lot of riders who are, you know, very good climbers, and then a lot of them will suffer, of course. So I think it's splitting up quite a lot, and we see they've come across because, you know, they seem to have pulled back a bit of time there, and certainly, you know, it's going to be the case, you know, inside 50 kilometres now, they have to get, you know, get into the action here. And I think we could see, you know, some maybe some more of them not too far off there, because that group coming over the top, there were, you know, there was quite a lot of riders coming over singly.
Yeah, quite a few. There is the big jersey wearer, Giovanni Visconti. So up ahead at the moment are Felix Cardenas, a multiple stage winner. The more I think about it, the more I think he has. I haven't got the stats to hand, to be honest. Cardenas, Baliani, Emanuele Sella, Bozioso and Kirienka in the front group. Hrach and Spillack were in the front group, but they've slipped backwards, and there's a fast-moving group, or groups, coming up behind, the most threatening of which appears to be Juan Manuel Garrato, Jürgen van den Broek, Sylvester Schmidt and Konstantin Suetsu. Further back a little more look like Maurizio Ardila had picked up Juan Hrach, but absolutely steaming across the gap was the Quickstep rider, the form of Ifipkin, who looked that way anyway. I'll just have to double check on that. We don't have confirmation, but Alexander Ifipkin, it looked like his style coming across the gap. There is Maurizio Sola, right in the middle of the shot. They've just pulled out wide from him, that sort of bobbing. Luca in the middle of the pack. There is Sola, just at the bottom of your shot. Right on his shoulder is Alberto Contador. So the next group of riders coming over the top, chucking a wrapper into the crowd, is Jens Vogt. This is really split up today, Sean, now, and it's a long time since we've seen so many splits in one day. Normally you get maybe two or three, but look, we've got about six or seven different groups on the road now.
Yes, and certainly, you know, there's been a bit of a battle on this climb from that group, and as we can see there, some of the riders, Astana coming through, the other two riders, Astana, Linsky and Bazayev, still in that group, but quite a long way down, lost a lot of time. So it's it seems like the groups that we see going through, not too far off that leading group, I think we could see them joining up.
And now just confirming the best climber standings at the moment, then Emanuele Sella now on 25, Cardenas on 11, Baliani on 6, Pietro Poli on 5, Laverde on 3 and Rick Verbrugge on 3 also. So Sella doing himself some good today. Matt Lloyd going over the top just there in the Australian National Champions jersey. He's a very good climber, I think, saving himself a little bit for the end of this Giro d'Italia. So dropping off the big climb of the day, or the longest climb of the day, the Reniero Sanitico. And trying to get as low a frontal area as possible is Felix Cardenas. This is the next group on the road. Van den Broek in the black and red. Konstantin Suetsu in the white and black at the back, the high road outfit. Sylvester Schmidt in the pink and blue there for Lampre. The other rider in the group is Juan Manuel Garrati, almost unmistakable form of Juan Manuel Garrati, former Spanish national champion. He's a very good climber as well. He won a stage here in the Giro with he was out on a break with Jens Vogt to let him go in the end, and he looked absolutely shell-shocked when he got there. Don't think he expected it at all. Well, it's all split to pieces at the moment. and there's no real concerted effort to take things back. Just lots of riders trying to get away and get across. Rather scrappy at the moment. We'll be able to see exactly what's going on. We're going to take a short commercial break. We'll try and establish all the gaps from all the groups when we come back. Live pictures here on stage 7. 624, you can see, is the gap between the pink jersey group and the head of the race today. That's Maxim Miglinski just being taken in. We just saw, as you came back live on air, one of the Barlow World riders in the escape being taken back. I would suggest it was Steve Cummings from Great Britain. And the big group of 32 that was away has split to pieces. Gradually, the pace is winding up behind in the peloton and beginning to take things back. It is Alexander Efimkin. Efimkin and Ardila. That is the second group on the road. The first group still consisting of Felix Cardenas, Fortunato Baliani and Emanuele Sella, both of the CFS Navigare group, Gabriele Bossioso of LPR and Vasily Kirienko. This is interesting, Sean, because the two guys, Azan Bazayev and Maxim Miglinski, who've been taken back from the group of 32, immediately staying on the front and doing a lot of work for Astana.
Yes, well, it's certainly interesting with Astana. We haven't really seen the riders except for, you know, in the final we have seen sometime the win of the tour last year.
Alberto Contador. That's
yes.
The one.
Yes, Contador. There's so many people in this breakaway trying to look at names here. I'm puzzled. But yes, Contador, we see him, you know, up towards the front quite a bit. And, you know, he's making a bit of shape. But certainly, you know, the other riders in the team. And when you look at Astana, who they've got, of course, you know, they've got some very good riders. The general classmate, Leipheimer, of course, is the one. He's been very quite clawed. And I think he has a very good chance in this race.
Yeah.
You know, he's there. We see in the finish he's just in the position where he's not in danger point of losing time on these little finishes which have, you know, 2 or 3 k's to the climb to the finish. And as we know, very good time trials in the mountains. We will see today, I suppose, a clearer picture. And today is the first day we can see maybe who is capable of winning the Giro, not who is going to win it, but maybe we could see some of the riders who were expected to do well losing a lot of time today and really going out of the position to have a challenge to get on the podium or win the race.
6:49 back from the lead group to the group of the Maia Rosa. That little comment, of course, brings me on to a question from Tony Gordon on Eurosport Cycling and Hotmail.fr, saying he thinks this is probably the most open Giro in years. Would you agree?
Yes, well, it's certainly a very open Giro, and I think you know, with the inclusion of the Astana team up to that, we could say you know, well, I think between those three or four riders now, it's opened out much more, of course, with the names I've mentioned from the Astana team. So it's going to be an interesting race, and I think it's, you know, it's better that we have more riders in that can challenge for the general classement, because then we will have a very good, I think, final week. We've had a, you know, a good start of this Giro, but I think that final week will be majorly spectacular.
Here then is the course. And you can see how winding it is through the central belt of Italy today. Just going through the sprint point at Castel di Sangro. And this is the beautiful town of Castel di Sangro. Not a problem for the points jersey today. Too many people up the road for them to worry about. Daniele Bernati will just make sure he can dig in and get over things for the next few days and start racking up points again when he needs to, but not at the moment. We've got the chase group now coming after our lead four, and this is interesting. Trying to push on are Maxim Iglinski and Azan Bazayev, and we've seen Alberto Contador sitting next to Maurizio Solar and just on the rear wheel of Danilo Di Luca, and they certainly want to chop the advantage down. Or more to the point, they want to push things on in the peloton. It's more a case of putting pressure on other people, you think, Sean, rather than trying to chase down people in front.
No, I think it's chasing down the front. Yes, a takedown the gap. It's, you know, 6:24 we see the last time check for the main bunch, and a lot of riders up there, as we see, who are, you know, pretty good in the general classement. So if you don't, if you do not store things up, certainly, you know, this gap is not going to come down a lot. And you know, Astana need to do that. They haven't really, they haven't got anybody up there now. Where, you know, a lot of the other teams have, you know, some good riders there, and if you give them, you know, 7 or 8 minutes and allow it to hang at 7 or 8 minutes on the final climb, you know, they maybe lose a minute or two, but still, it's, you know, it's too dangerous. So certainly, Astana are, you know, taking the race in their hands for the first time, and of course today is the day. It's the really difficult stage, and Contador, of course, if it comes to the final, you know, he could be a danger man. But also, not only that, for a stage victory, maybe the general classement, which, you know, with three riders in the team, they have to, you know, keep them in contention and not to allow a situation where we've seen the Tour of France, a group get away and take a huge amount of time, and they hang on to the jersey, those guys, for a long ways towards the end of the race.
Well, to be fair, though, I mean, none of these guys here in this group are within striking distance of the jersey, and they're all over 10 minutes down on the GC, and at the moment the group is about 6:50 down. Seller, of course, out there for a particular reason. He's trying to get points for the green jersey that he's wearing at the moment, the mountain climber's jersey. A group at 2:52, rather more interesting group. They've got Alexander Efimkin in there. I wonder if they think that Efimkin might be a danger man a bit later on, and they don't want to let him get up the road. Of course, Juan Manuel Garate as well is quite capable of climbing. Maybe not a super, super climb, but an exceptionally good one. But it is interesting to see that Astana not allowing things to slow down. Having get Oglinski and As Anbaze are back in the group, they're still at the front and plugging away quite happily, pushing the pace along, and everything's really strung out. Director Sportif Sean Yates in the car, giving them the hurry-up call and dragging things along now. So on the left-hand side, you can see everybody at the head of the race. Then there's the group in the middle, chasing, including Adila in the Rabobank colours there, and Alexander Efimkin at the back. And then on the right-hand side, that's Azan Bazayev and Maxim Iglinski doing the work on the front of the peloton, 6.5 minutes back. General classification here on stage six, as it stands at the moment. Visconti ahead of Priamo, Pellazzotti, De Luca. These are just selected men in the general classification. Giovanni Visconti will enjoy his day in the pink, and Quickstep making the best use of the work being done by Astana on the front. They've got a couple of men in just sitting behind our Astana duo. There we are then. It is Vasto to Pesco Costanzo. 180 kilometres today in the Giro d'Italia on stage seven. Three categorized climbs before a mountaintop finish. The first one was at 118 kilometers, the Valico di Macaron, won by Emanuele Sella ahead of Felix Cardenas and Baliani. This is the points at the moment. Benati ahead of Rico, Pavel Brut, and then Mark Cavendish. The second categorized climb came after 136 kilometers, the Roniero Sanitico. Again, Sella ahead of Cardenas and Baliani. They've just gone through the sprint point at Castel di Sangro. Doesn't really affect the points classification at all. Benati way, way down in the peloton, some 6 minutes down. But this is how things have stacked up so far. This is what we started off with yesterday. I'm afraid that's changed from now on. That's out of date, that graphic. Let's just look and see exactly how the overall favourites sit within the standings now. Franco Pellazzotti, the former pink jersey wearer, is now 9:08, with De Luca 7 seconds behind him, Nibali at 8. It was debatable with you. Nibali will be there at the end. Savoldelli at 19, Clodin at 105, Solar at 113. That's interesting. Rico they have down at 33 there. Simone at 102, Leipheim at 103. Menchov at 105. Rujano, they still persist in putting the Venezuelan Jose Rujano as a main favourite at 105. And Solar at 113, we just had seen him already. I think it's a bit of a mix-up on those graphics. We'll sort those out for you. Rujano, let's be sensible, Sean. He did fantastically well a couple, two or three years ago in the Giro d'Italia, running for Sella Italia. Really a favourite?
Well, I think if you look back at his performance, you know, he did the business when will he get the lucky breaks? You know, he got into the classement a number of years ago by getting into breaks in the very end of the race, but he did finish very strong, and I doubted if we're going to see him, you know, repeating that performance. But he's had 2 years rest, so maybe he's, you know, recovered. And
that's a very nice way of putting it, 2 years rest.
Well, he certainly has, because we haven't seen him really at all. He hasn't.
That's the point, though, isn't it? We've not seen him because he's just not been capable of it.
Well, you know, he's been going to quite good teams, and I presume he's, you know, getting, you know, a contract on his performances from 2 years in the Tour of Italy, and that's going to run out. And if he doesn't produce this year, I can't see him going to a big team, and so maybe that will get a bit of a push on. And a lot of the times the Royals like that, they can get a bit lazy, and when they have to do a performance, they're able to, you know, turn it up.
Is it not the case though with Rujano, and he was hired by Quickstep for an awful lot of money? He wasn't used to that sort of money, coming from Venezuela straight into Sella Italia. He was hired on a lot of money, and the wheels all fell off. His head went to pieces, and he actually went back to Venezuela, didn't he?
Yes, well, that's you know, a familiar one in pro bike racing. If you look back through the years and through my career, you know, you always have riders like that who are in a small team, a very small contract, and, you know, really have to work hard. And a good contract, you know, they don't be able to keep their feet on the ground, as they say, and for some reason, you know, just really go off. And some of them we never see again, because when you lose it, it's so hard to get back. And others, you know, they have maybe 2 years, 3 years where they do nothing, and then suddenly, you know, the good time starts to run out and they start producing performances again. So we have to see, and this year certainly I think will be the year when we will see Rugano. Can he come back, or is he just, you know, is it over really?
It's amazing what the lure of an empty bank balance will do. Leonardo Piepoli, winner of the green jersey last year in the Giro d'Italia, just sitting in there at the moment with the rest of his teammates from, or a couple of his teammates from Sonia de Val. There's our leader from yesterday, Giovanni Visconti, and he'll keep that jersey as one of his proudest, the first Grand Tour jersey that he's got. Here we are with the second group on the road. That is Konstantin Suetsu that you are looking at, the high road rider, just sitting in the wheels of Sylvester Schmidt from Lampre. And Maurizio Ardila, the man doing the work on the front at the moment, the little chap in the orange and blue, another very good climber who never really quite made it. The problem with Ardila, it seems to be, was that he was hired by Rabobank, and it's taken him two or three years to get used to the sort of the different ways things are done in a Dutch team. I think he was pitched into it, Sean, and didn't have an awful lot of support in the same way as perhaps he'd have had in a smaller team. Just had to sort of get on with it, and that didn't really suit him for a couple of years.
Certainly not, and I think we talked about it last year, and he was living in Holland in a hotel, and certainly, you know, it wasn't a good place for him. And of course, you know, a rider like Ardila, you have to live where there's, you know, a bit more hilly country. Of course, you can go to parts of Holland where it is hilly, but it's not what you call hills for those guys. And, you know, he should be living in a place where he can climb big mountains in training. And I think it was a bad decision for him to move there to live, first of all, because you know, it's certainly his performances, you know, really went downhill and hasn't been doing anything. So again, you know, it's a number of years since he was riding well. We see him with Lotto a number of years ago in the Tour of Italy. He was very, very, you know, strong in the final week of the race, but since he have moved to Rabobank, we haven't seen him do any great performances.
Talking of moving around, it's fascinating, isn't it, to see so many of these continental teams like this one here, LPR Brakes. LPR been around for two or three years. They're in the sort of silver colours with the green bands around their shorts. Just behind the graphic, you'll see in a minute, they have last year's winner Danilo De Luca in the team. Now, in a couple, two or three years ago, Sean, who would have suggested that second string teams like LPR brakes, or Decco Giovanni, which was formerly, of course, Sell Italia, would have had riders of the calibre of Danilo Di Luca and Gilberto Simoni riding for them. It's almost beggars belief, doesn't it?
Yes, well, you know, you could not have... You could not imagine it, you know, 3-4 years ago when we started out with Pro Tour and Pro Tour teams. They were to be invited to the big tours and all the big races, and the plan was to take, you know, the top 20 Pro Tour teams, and that was it. But of course, the organisers, from the beginning, there was problems with the UCI on that one, because they wanted to invite smaller teams, Tour of Italy, Tour of France, Tour of Spain, the wild card, as they call it, and they wanted to have a number of wild cards. And I feel that was, you know, I said in the beginning, it was always going to be a major difficulty for big tours to accept that from the UCI, because, you know, you have to understand there's always one or two teams who are quite strong, not Pro Tour, of course, but able to put up a good performance, and I think merit a place in the international tour. And you know, it was a problem right from the beginning.
Tinkoff, continental team, not Pro Tour team. LPR here, number three for Bossioso, continental team, not Pro Tour. We've got also in this group, in fact, everybody in this group is from. Us, Emanuele Sella in this group as well. Every team here is non-Pro Tour. Let's ask the very big question then. In your opinion, is the Pro Tour dead?
Well, it looks like it's going to, you know, have a major struggle for the heat to survive. And we see, you know, the last, certainly the last year and a half, it's, you know, more, and certainly the beginning of this year, more of a problem again with the Paris-Nice and ASO, the organisation for that organised the Tour of France, and of course many other races like Paris-Nice, Paris-Roubaix, Liège-Bastogne-Liège, and you know, it's got more problematic with the Pro Tour situation, and I feel like it is going to, you know, struggle for the Pro Tour to continue. Because if you look at the teams here, for example, the riders going to continental pro teams, and they're, you know, getting into, you know, 80% of the good races. So I feel there'll be a lot of continental teams will be taking, you know, big names, and that will pretty much guarantee them a place in the big classic race of the big tours.
Decco Giovanni and Sonny Deval on the front. We'll take a short commercial break. We'll be back for the finale of today's stage. Our breakaway riders are within the last 25 kilometres. This is the second group on the road, approaching the 25 to go banner. Our lead men, Bossioso from LPR, Fortunato Baliani and Emanuele Sella, both from CFS Navigare. Felix Cardenas from the Barlow World Squad and Vasily Kirienka behind the group that we just could see. This is the lead group on the road, 4:17 back to the peloton. Behind this group of five are Maurizio Ardila, Sylvester Schmidt, Juan Manuel Garate, Jürgen van den Broek, Konstantin Suetsu, Alexandre Fibkin and Juan Hrač. They are at 3:40. And behind the peloton are beginning to close in. It's Decco Giovanni, that's Gilberto Simoni's squad, and Ricardo Rico's Sonia Deval's squad coming to the front now, doing a little work. Astana had kick-started things. Do you think that was the intention, Sean, for Astana to get the thing moving, to try and sort of really kick-start a few other teams to do some work on the front?
Yes, and you know, sometimes there is a situation where everybody's playing the waiting game. Who's going to take up the work on the front and put a number of riders out there? And when the team starts, a lot of the time we see the other teams with favours for the end of this, the end classment of this race, you know, getting on board as well and starting to ride. And you know, it only maybe takes a couple of kilometres. And you know, certainly if you're a team like Alstan, as I said, you have to start it, you know, and if you hang around, keep on waiting. And we've seen that on a number of times where you wait too long and then it's too late. So you know, just get on with the job, get up there and start doing it. And hopefully there will be other teams who will come on board. And we see the situation here, there is teams who, you know, are coming on board with Astana.
These five doing a good job though at the moment. Fortunato Baliani, I think, beginning to suffer a little bit. but still plugging away. Looking good at the moment is Bozioso at the front. Emanuele Sella gritting his teeth, second in line here in the green with the orange helmet from CFS Navigare. Vasily Kirienko is the man of the stone face in the Tinkoff colours. And the last man in the group is climber Felix Cardenas in the red of Barlow World. Barlow World, a multinational company. It's an umbrella company, really, for a whole group of industries. And Astana again are back on the front. Azan Bazayev once again driving things along with Maxim Iglinski, the Kazakh national champion, in his wheel tracks. Sonia Naval lying third in this line out, just dragging things along. Had a little bit of a break, had a little bit of a rest, and then Sean Yates has given them the hurry up again. Get on the front and start working for Alberto Contador. The one problem, I would guess, with Astana, Sean, is that they've almost got too many chiefs and not enough Indians.
Well, it's a good thing to have if they're prepared to become Indians when you need them.
Yeah, that's the thing, though, isn't
and,
it?
And we have to wait and see. And I think that won't be enough. That won't be a problem when we get into the mountains. You know, and you have to use your Indians at the moment and you know, get the thing moving and try and you know, get this gap, take it down a bit, and later on we can see. But the group up front and the breakaway, like, is still working very well and still holding on to a quite a good advantage. And it'll be interesting, you know, if the if there's really, you know, some pace injection as we get into this the final part of this stage, because there is, you know, some very difficult terrain still to come. This gap could come down quite a lot, because these riders have been out there for a long time, and especially the breakaway riders are starting to tire. The other ones, the chasing group, maybe, you know, they're coming out of that big group of 32 riders a little bit fresher, but still they seem to be holding on our leaders off that chasing group, and I think we could see those holding on, some of them certainly holding on all the way to the finish.
Looks like Nardello coming to the front to do his turn for Dequa Giovanni now. Pulling off Sonia Deval's is Ricardo Rico's team. Gilberto Simone's Dequa Giovanni team doing their fair share on the front. And once again, a couple of Astana riders lurking around three or four places there. At what point, Sean, does it become very difficult if you've got two or three or even possibly four guys who could be leaders? Well, we'll just talk about that in just a second. Live pictures here on stage 7 of the Giro d'Italia. The run in two for Oscar Costanzo today, and the first mountaintop finish. Not one of the really big ones, but still nasty. Just under 3 kilometres of the last climb. They've been over two already. The 9.4-kilometre Reniero Sanniticchio, being the first category climb of the day. Emanuele Sella has been notching up extra points to add to his already a blossoming lead in the green. Or is it if you have, you know, go beyond the three really big stars in a team?
Well, I think, you know, you get further into the race, because we've seen nothing in this race yet as goes for the general classement and who is in form. And looking at a standard team, of course, we mentioned the three. The three riders capable of doing a very good general classement and even winning the race, but are they, you know, in good enough shape this time of year? We talked about earlier on as well, they haven't been doing a lot of the very big races this year, and will that, you know, take effect as we go into the final week? But you have to, you know, control the situation at the moment, and they're only using the, you know, the domestiques at the moment, and further on in the race then we will see who's the best rider. And I suppose, you know, the time trials will also tell. We have to wait to get to the first time trial and see who's, if they're still in contention, and if they still have three, well, it's a great position to be in, because then you can play many cards. And as we see today in this race, it's a bit like that in the Giro, you know, they a lot of attacks in the mountain stages very early on, a big group go away, and if
mistakes. It's a point well made, though, isn't it? The fact that they weren't expecting to be invited to this particular race. And although they've been training hard and in very good form, will they be in the right level of form is the question. They certainly knew they weren't going to go to the Tour de France, so the Giro may not have been on their radar. They may have just prepared just in case something happened. And they got a very last-minute call-up about 8 days beforehand at the expense of one of the other continental teams here in Italy, and not a good situation for them, having spent an awful lot of money making sure that they could come up to scratch, really. 20 kilometers to go for our breakaway riders, our five at the front. Cardenas is the man right at the back here in the white, red and yellow of Barla World, and then just ahead of him, Emanuele Sella, hunched over his bars as he normally is, number 61 for CFS Navigari. Just ahead of him, his teammate Fortunato Baliani, and also in the group, Gabriele Bosicio, that man's teammate, Danilo De Luca's teammate, and Vasily Kirienka, who looks fairly cool and calm to me. However, not a noted climber, but a very, very good track man, a very good strong man. Then there's a group in the middle chasing things down, and you can see it in the middle box of your screen there. You are looking at Konstantin Suetsu in the high road colours, sitting behind Sylvester Schmidt with Juan Manuel Garate behind him in the quick step colours. Actually, the last shot of the middle group we saw, it looked like Maurizio Ardila and Juan Arach were having a bit of trouble, so that's being thinned down a bit, and the pressure coming on the front from Jürgen van den Broek there. They know that the peloton's got the hurry-up call, and they want to stay away as long as possible. There's Ricardo Rico. Well, Rico had a damaged left hand following a crash on stage two, and all sorts of very romantic and graphic images of him bringing to mind his great hero Marco Pantani as he cycled and battled through the pain to get to the line, and then had a sound thrashing of the organizers for the conditions on the road. Didn't like it at all. Well, he talks the big talk, does Ricardo Rico. Is he capable of walking the big walk, Sean, in your particular opinion?
Well, he's walked a bit of it. He's won a stage and won a very good stage, so I think, you know, that's probably took a little bit of pressure off him, relaxed him a bit, and he seems to be comfortable. And, of course, the crash, I think he came out of that one lucky, because it could have been, you know, much worse. He could have broke a finger, and if you have a broken bone, of course, well, then it's, you know, it just hurts you. You can't continue on, but it's quite painful on the bike, and your braking also is hindered. And his director sportif, Pietro Algieri, was saying in the paper there 2 days ago, you know, he was really lucky. He said that the way he came out of it, he just got bruising, and he said it was just a really lucky day. It's unlucky in one way, but when you come out of a crash like that, you can call yourself being real lucky. So interesting to see from here on, you know, has Rico got it? And I just don't know. In the big tours, the last week is the thing where it's really difficult recovery. You know, the fatigue starts to set in, and I think he will be up there with the best of them. But is he good enough to win the race or get on the podium? I just don't know.
Look at this. Now LPR coming to the front. The big rangy hatchet face rider Alessandro Spezialetti on the front. A superb rider in his own right, Spezialetti, but he could have done so much more in his own career, but he's made a career as a wonderful domestique, and he's now splitting the bunch to pieces. There is the pink jersey of Giovanni Visconti, just on the wheel of teammate Paolo Bettini, the world champion in the rainbow bands there. And that pink jersey is going to go down the Swanee today for Giovanni Visconti. I'm not a surprise, though, for that, but a big dig in by Alessandro Spezialetti for Danilo De Luca. He's got one, two, there's De Luca just behind him on the green De Rosa bike, unlike the silver ones for the rest of the team. Jürgen van den Broek still piling on the pressure here at the front with 20 kilometers to go. He's been sat at the front of this group for a long time now, Sean, and it's whittling down bit by bit. Harach has gone, Ardila's gone, looks like a Fimpkin has gone as well. Garate is still in there, But the Jürgen van den Broek doing a fine job.
Yes, and he looks to be in good shape today, and it's interesting to see him because he's a rider we talked about. Back to as he was some time ago, and he certainly seems to be on a good one today. But 3:30 still for this chasing group of van den Broek, and 3:55 back to the bunch. And as we see, we're getting into the last 15 kilometres for our leaders, and they're on this climb, which is 9 kilometres. And if there's a big battle in the bunch, we could see it melting down quite a lot. But 3:55 up front, if they still have got some energy and some energy left, I think we could possible to see them holding on. So it's going to be a very interesting final.
Well, they're within catching distance now. The front of the peloton can see them going up the road. Antonio Colom is the rider from Astana in the light blue, white and black there. Ricardo Rico in the yellow, sitting on the wheel of Danilo Di Luca. Paolo Bettini doing the domestique's job. Now, how often do you see a world champion helping out a teammate in a situation like this? Bettini, the world champion, leading Visconti, the leader in the race. They'll have enjoyed his day in Pig. Well, enjoy is probably the wrong word. He probably hasn't enjoyed the day. He enjoyed it last night, I would imagine. And at just behind the wheel of Visconti, I think it's Rus. Or was it Frohlinger? I think it's Frohlinger, maybe. Well, that's the end of that break with Jürgen van den Broek, having pushed along fairly nicely. He's been caught by the incredible pace injection from Alessandro Specialezzi. So Garatti now looking over his shoulder to see where everybody is. And a different set of riders now will take up the challenge at the front, because these three teams, Silence Lotto, High Road and Quickstep, not really too concerned at the moment. Back in the front group then, and Vasily Kirienka for Tinkoff. Well, he's a tall chap. And a rather strange garb as well. You get them all here. You get them on the Tour de France as well. There is Visconti. Can you remember how you felt, Sean, the very first day you took your first Grand Tour jersey?
It's a major achievement, and when you get a jersey in a big tour, it's something special. And the race leader's jersey, of course, that's more than anything. When you get a points jersey or a mountain jersey, it's not the same, unless you win it outright, of course. But when you get the race leader's jersey, and I remember quite clearly my jersey in the Tour of France, and I took the yellow jersey, although it was for a very brief occasion, for one day, it's still it's quite fresh in my memory.
Well, the pace just slackening a little at the front. Specialezzi and crew have taken back the middle group, and now Giovanni Visconti's group coming back towards the rear of Di Luca's peloton group. Antonio Colom moving up on the outside. Di Luca, one of these guys you see a lot of, not so much emotion in his face, but he certainly, he shows his pain in his face, does Di Luca. Anytime there's an injection of pace and he's not feeling quite so good, or he's having some effort, it shows. We were discussing with a friend last night, a rider who isn't here actually, Fabian Wegman, is a man who wears every emotion on his face. And we've seen him actually in the Tour of Lombardy burst into tears as he was chasing a rider so hard it would hurt so much. There are riders who wear their emotions on their face. Here's another one, Fortunato Baliani, shows all their efforts. And the same with Emanuele Sella. Baliani, I thought a little bit while ago, was beginning to suffer, and he's now being distanced very slightly by Kirienka. Sella, who's looking over his shoulder to see where he is, Felix Cardenas and Bossioso. But certain riders can wear a complete mask of, stony face mask, and then you never see anything about them. They, of course, the great one being at one time Miguel Indurain. But other riders just wear their emotions all over their face.
Yes, certainly, and you know, this not only on the face as well in the pedalling rhythm. Some guys, like, you know, they just can sit there and pedal away, and it looks like they're always comfortable. And when they're, you know, starting to suffer big time, they still keep on that same, you know, that pedalling, and you cannot see it, but other riders, and they start rolling the shoulders and making a lot of movement on the bike. So you know, it's pretty easy to see that, but a lot of the time the riders as well, you can see it in their face. You know, most of the riders, I think, can see it in their face when they're starting to suffer.
Well, I'll tell you what, old Visconti is doing a good job here, because at the moment he's sitting just behind Paolo Bettini. And Spezialetzi begins to slide backwards, having done his particular job. That he's done very well so far, Giovanni Visconti. He's got a lead of 1 minute and 22 seconds over Daniele Nardello, who was with him at that particular time, was beginning to suffer. 4:42 over Perez, Alain Perez. Gavazzi is at 5:34. The first of the really big names, Franco Pellizzotti at 9 minutes and 8 seconds. Di Luca at 9:15. Possoni at 9:16. And at the moment, he's doing a good job.
Yes, he is, and we could see there with Bettini, they just, you know, kept it a bit steady on the climb. When there was a sudden acceleration there, he lost contact in the bunch and just kept working it away, and that's the way to do it, because if you try and stay in the bunch there and go into the red, and you can just blow big time and never recover again, never get your rhythm going. With Bettini, they, you know, they calculated it quite well, and you know, they're still just hanging there a bit off the rear of the bunch, but if it's not really, you know, the pace not turned up on the front of the bunch, they could, you know, hang in on this climb and get back on. And if he does that on the final climb to the finish, it's going to be difficult, but he's certainly doing a better job than I was you know, hoping from him today. So he's hanging in very well, and it's amazing, you know, a rider, normally he might be, you know, drop much further back down the road today. With the Jersey riders, you know, they can really up their performance.
Maybe it's something impossibly about the way that the pace of the peloton has been acting. I know it's a split and resplit. Visconti still fighting to get back on the wheel here, but that's Kevin Sildres, 1:37 there. And that looks an awful lot to me like Leonardo Piepoli. And Piepoli now by himself. Well, just going back to Visconti for a second. Visconti, oh, well, I mean, it's going to be, it's almost going to be a tall order to lose 9 minutes now on, say Pellizzotti or Di Luca. But what we haven't seen, we've seen Nardello suffering from behind. We've not seen Alain Perez yet at all. We don't know if he's in that main group or not. We don't know if Gavazzi is in the main group. We don't know where they're. We know that Rus was supposed to be near the group of Visconti, but when you look back at it, there's only three or four riders, and Rus wasn't in there wearing the number 99 bib. We'll just have to see exactly. It's a fascinating situation, because there is Giovanni Visconti working his way back onto this group, this main group. We'll have to look for the Gerolsteiner jersey with bib number 99 of Mateus Rus, who has exactly the same time in an overall classification. 2 minutes 15-ish, roughly, from the peloton up to this escape group. Kirienka in the yellow at the front, then Bocioso in the silver colours behind, wearing number 3. The red of Felix Cardenas, the Colombian, and the little Italian Emanuele Seller in number 61. That's all that remains of the 11 riders that started off, the 7 riders that started off earlier today. Still working hard, Visconti. This will be one of the hardest days of his career, I would imagine, Sean.
Yes, it certainly will, and it's a day where he's, you know, really going to have to fight big time to hang in here, and all the way to the line he's going to, you know, really push it, because the jersey, you know, it's a great occasion for him to hold on to the jersey. If he had lost contact in the beginning of this climb immediately and there was a big battle up front, you know, the gap would grow out big time. But he's certainly, you know, fighting on greatly here, and it looks like that, you know, if the bunch keeps on at this pace, he could just hang in there for quite a lot of this climb. And if he does that, well, then he's pretty secure of, you know, staying close to the jersey. He has to look at the other ones that were up in the general classement, of course, which were on the break yesterday, depending on how they will do the last climb, how they can hang hang in there with the leader. So it's going to be once again a battle for the race leader jersey today between those guys.
Pierpoli trying to pull out some sort of lead on everybody else now. These are our four breakaway riders. Ah, it's nice to see the Tifosi out, fueled by Grappa and Vino. Visconti then back in the group. Well, that was a good bit of riding.
He's watching Rus, staying close to him.
And who wouldn't after all? Mateusz Rus in the white jersey. He's not actually leading on the best young riders classification. There he is. He's not leading it, he's second in it, but because Visconti is leading it, he's already wearing one jersey, it passes down to him. He's just having a good look across to see if Rus is suffering at all. Daniele Nardello, the veteran Deco Giovanni rider, is certainly suffering. He was at 122 this morning. Alan Perez from Euskaltel Escari started the day at 442 down. We've not seen him at all. I wouldn't be surprised if he's in that front group. He's a good climber. There's a lookout for the bib number 78. And I don't see that many Euskaltel riders in the group. Leonardo Pierpoli now trying to get away from the main group by himself. A winner here in the Giro d'Italia in stages in the past. Also a winner of the green climber's jersey last year. Oh, look at this. Danilo De Luca's just come flying out of the front of the peloton. We just caught this with Ricardo Rico on his wheel. Well, Rico's got Pierpoli up the road and some instant reaction from Joaquim Rodriguez. Joaquim Rodriguez, and it looks like the unmistakable style of Alberto Contador, who's got onto his wheel. Is that Wim van Huffel, the Lotto rider, who's trying very hard to get back, but is no way he's got an answer to the explosive power of Danilo Di Luca. Rico looking very, very settled in second place. Joaquim Rodriguez bridges the gap very quickly. And Alberto Contador has gone onto the wheel of Rodriguez, his fellow Spaniard, riding for a different team, of course, though. Pierpoli looking over his shoulder. Now he sees his team leader coming up behind him. Are they just going to slacken off and allow it all to just regroup a little bit? I don't think so. This is a very concerted attack, and Rico now takes it up. Well, maybe this answers the question. He's got Pierpoli with him, so he's got his super climbing domestique with him. And Contador straight onto the wheel of De Luca. He doesn't want to be left behind. And Rodriguez has decided, nope, that's not for me. That is not for me. I can't stay with that. He's looking behind. Rodriguez, who has his clear agenda for himself this time, because Alejandro Valverde is not here. Pierpoli now looking down to see how much of a gap they've got already. Well, that was an enormous attack, Sean.
Yes, it certainly was, a really explosive one. And it was surprising to me that he did attack here. But of course, De Luca, he is that type. He's, a very aggressive rider. If he feels good, he will go in the attack. And of course, up front, he has a teammate here, Bossioni. If he can get across to this group, well, then he has a man who can ride as well. As we can see them, the gap, I think, was around 3 minutes at the moment for the group of De Luca, Pipoli, and it's going to be interesting. If they really work together well here, they could pull that back, but still 3 minutes is a long way as they go through here with about 13 kilometers to go.
The escape group has just gone over the top of the Pietransieri, and De Luca fighting now to hang onto the wheel of Alberto Contador. Rico is making people hurt now. I think De Luca is having real trouble. He's really digging. I love De Luca as a fighting rider. He has absolute aggression. And he's showing it now, and he's having to really dig in. Alberto Contador, by far the more accelerative climber. A real natural climber and a burst of speed by Ricardo Rico and Leonardo Pierpoli have made Danilo De Luca really suffer. I think he's, having launched that attack, it's taken a big, big chunk out of what he's got left.
Yes, he's certainly suffering big time here, but he's a great fighter and he will just hang in there. And I think he can stay there because Pipoli is a very steady climber. And when you look at Pipoli there, it looks like he's not really going fast. He, for a climber, he puts a quite a big year and roars along, but certainly De Luca is suffering. But I think, yes, he will get over this one, and it'll be interesting, as we can see from back in the bunch, there's a number of riders trying to come across the gap, so there's going to be a big scatter in the bunch here, because you know, there's going to be concern here with those riders out in front.
We don't know what's happening behind, what's happening to riders like Gilberto Simoni. Oh, it's a massive gap already. One of the Lampre boys out ahead at the moment. Well, almost look like Brüsigin. Come. Very strong rider. And now Deco Giovanni trying to drag things back together. Deco Giovanni working for, of course, Gilberto Simoni. And it looked like this hunched form of Jose Serpa. This is the best climber standings now. That's not really where the action is, though. We know Sella's got the points there. He's ahead of Cardenas, Baleani, Pietro Poli, Bossiosi, and Laverda now in that order. But this is where the action is, in the left-hand box. Giovanni Visconti and Matthias Rus. Well, they are watching each other, because they started on equal time today, with Visconti taking the pink jersey yesterday by dint of having better finishes over the last week. This is the four that counts at the moment. There's still riders from behind are going to have to try and come across and do something about this, because that is very, very difficult indeed. That is Jose Serpa, the Colombian rider on the front, trying to drag things back together for his team leader Gilberto Simoni. And well, have some of the big favourites been caught napping, is the question.
Well, I don't think so, because, you know, there's quite a bit to go here, and there's 13 kilometres as we start to go downhill for a bit here, and 26 seconds for that group of the Simoni group on the group of De Luca. So, it's not impossible for them to come across that gap, and there's quite a number of riders in that group of Simoni. So I think, there is riders and teams who will ride here, and it's, you know, it goes down for a bit, and then it's, you know, a little bit more undulating before we get this final run up to the finish. And we see for De Luca, Contador 2:38 on the leader, so still quite a good advantage for our breakaway riders out front.
So the four big names up ahead: Piepoli, Rico, De Luca, and Contador. That is Gabriele Bossioso from LPR. Up ahead, there are still four men: Kirienko, Bossioso, Emanuele Sella, and Felix Cardenas on the road. But the big actions come behind here. Slightly strange time for Danilo De Luca to attack, but when he did, Riccardo Rico went straight with him, and then Alberto Contador was on them like a jackrabbit straight away. And Leonardo Piepoli had already gone out of the front of the peloton. That was a bit less surprising, I think, because Piepoli, a noted climber, has won here the green jersey for best climber before and won stages here. Perhaps that was a little less surprising, but certainly, do you think it was the wrong time for De Luca to go, Sean?
Well, yeah, it's you'd wonder the tactic of De Luca at that moment, you know, but as I said, he's that style of rider. He's capable of attacking at any time, at any moment, and even, you know, maybe he's not feeling 100%, he still goes in the attack, and we see that he paid the price for the attack, but it's working out to be a good move here, because we see the Sonia Duval riders are going to, you know, pull this one along, and of course, you know, the one with Piepoli, that was the one I was going to say, what's he doing out there? Why is he going off ahead of the bunch on his own? But I think also the Sonia Duval had a tactic there, that Rico was going to try something before they got to the top of this climb, which they've just went over. So it's really, you know, opened up the race here, and for the group behind, it's also interesting, because the likes of Simoni and co, they're going to have to ride as well to try and get this one back.
Let's just have a look at the front of this, and this is the front group, and it's Emanuele Sella from CFS Navigare. They've had a win yesterday with Priamo Sella, the mountains classification jersey wearer. He's making an attempt to get away, but Vasily Kirienka dragging the other riders, Bossioni and Cardenas, back to the wheel of Emanuele Sella. A wonderfully elegant rider, Vasily Kirienka, even if he does hit the deck occasionally. Cardenas
in trouble.
In trouble, yeah. That's him. That's
surprising.
Well, I don't know, actually. I'm not particularly surprised. He does tend to do this. He tends to go over a coat these days. Although he's had great days in the mountains, he does have days when he goes out, figures in mountain breaks, and then just falls away towards the end. Back to these two, then. And it's now to Bozioso, of course, the teammate of that man there, Danilo Di Luca. But Kirienka, very elegant style, obviously, when he doesn't get in the way of everybody else. And obviously very strong indeed, Franco Pellizzotti.
Well, I think, bike riders in the career, they all make mistakes. And
for
Kirienko, it was, a situation there where the road kind of opened out and he thought he would get away with it by moving up on the, way into a parking
or
something.
That's right,
but,
of
course, unluckily for him, the sand was there, and unluckily more so for the others, McGee and O'Grady really came out the worst of it.
Yes, poor old Vasily Kirienka, not the most popular person that evening around the dinner tables at the hotels, but like you say, Sean, it happens, doesn't it?
We all get it in our careers.
Ooh, yeah.
I certainly, can put my hand up, and I've made mistakes as well at moments. And, it's something that when you're on the, pretty close on the limit and pushing it, there's times where you're going to get it wrong.
What's the worst mistake you ever made?
In the Tour of Switzerland, at the top of a climb, it was on a plateau, and for a couple of k's, and we got in a big group of 50 riders, put my hand in my pocket to get some food, and there was a pothole, and went into the pothole, lost my handlebars, went down with my hand in my pocket getting food, and took 20-30 riders out.
Oh. Mr. Popular then in the evening, I'm sure you were, yeah. Never mind. Still, Leonardo Piepoli at the front with Riccardo Rico in his wheel tracks. Di Luca still hanging in there. Alberto Contador at the back of this group of a real wonderful climber. Is Contador just bounces on those pedals, able to react uphill very, very quickly indeed. Bozioso has a rather short stance, actually. Bozioso, he's when he sits on the bike, I know he's perched on the saddle, but he is rather short on the top tube. Really tucked in and having a go for it now. Kirienka thinks, no, thank you, I'm not going to let you do that. I've seen Seller have a go at it, but unfortunately, I'm a very good time trialist, and I think I'm going to try and track you down. He's going to, Bossioso's given it a hard dig, though. And there's no way on this sort of terrain, Sean, that poor old Emmanuel Seller can compete with these two.
No, certainly not. It's, real big gear stuff here, and a powerful rider. Time trial, as you said, it's a perfect section of road for that. But he doesn't seem to be at the high end of the wheels, because he should be able to sit on the wheel, and if you can, tuck in tightly in the wheel, he should be able to hang on to those guys. So I think he is also suffering quite a lot.
Bozioso, who won the Tour of Latium last year, if you remember, and has had some good places in, well, I'd say not minor tours, yeah, Tour of Austria and so on. Hasn't had too many wins to his career, but won the Giro d'Oro this year, which is a tough old race early on in the season. So he's pretty good race, 220. From the front group, including Bozioso, of course, his teammate, and to the Danilo Di Luca group. Danilo Di Luca, remember, he's riding in the grey colours of LPR. He's in that group there. He's bidding to become the first Italian to retain the Giro d'Italia title since Franco Balmamian back in 1963. Wonderful book just published on Franco Balmamian's first victory in 1962, where he took the fight to Nino De Filippis, Charlie Gall, and others, of course. Called The Eagle of the Canavesi. Hugely well written by first-time writer Herbie Sykes. Well worth reading, and it looks as if Bozioso has got a little bit more in the tank than the elegant Kirienka at the moment. That's Fortunato Baliani has been picked up by our four-man group, including the two Sonia Naval riders of Piepoli and Ricardo Rico. Well, I'm not quite sure where Emanuele Sella is. I think race radio, I think I heard something on race radio about possibly he had a puncture. Not so good for Sella, but even so, he would have had the worst possible time for him to have a puncture within the last 10 kilometres and on a flat section where he has not a hope in hell of keeping up with Kirienka and Bozioso. There is Rico. Well, our four escapees from the peloton have become five, with Fortunato Baliani being swept up by them. Still a handy old gap.
Well, it's coming down. It's coming down, certainly. I think it was a bit more. Certainly on the top of the climb, we see that gap was around the 26 seconds, and it is coming down. And the Quickstep are doing, you know, a good job here. And the interesting one, Contador, is just sitting here, and he's not, you know, contributing at all at this riding up front. And it comes to this situation once again. You know, he's a general classement rider, but what is the tactic here? I suppose he's saying, well, the leader is closer in our team, and I'm just here to, you know, to pilot this situation. He's certainly doing that, not contributing anything. But I think we will see the bunch coming back and catching up with this group of Contador de Luca.
Of course, we were talking about earlier, you've got three major names in their team, Astana. Any one of them could have followed this and all say the same thing when the press asks them afterwards. Our team leader is somebody else, and I'm just doing my job. Makes it very difficult for other teams, but they all know that. It's bike racing, that's the way it is. There's Franco Pellizzotti, the man just behind him in the Spanish national champions jersey and shorts is Joaquim Rodriguez. There is Andreas Klöden sitting on the wheel of Franco Pellizzotti. Joaquim Rodriguez immediately having a go and trying to bring back, or trying to go with the group of four, and deciding, no, that's not going to happen.
4K.
And Bossioso is now going for it. He's got the call up from the car, the hurry up from the car. Now, they're going to take all this back. Is there going to be another big attack? We're actually on the last climb of the day, almost. Almost. It is going up here, but this is not. It's little digs and troughs and digs and troughs all the way towards the last climb. And 229, 230, 231, 233 is the gap as they go with 5 kilometres to go from Bozioso back to De Luca. He's not that concerned about the stage victory today. It's he and Rico battling for the general classification now. Contador sitting third back at the moment. Rico is second in the yellow, then Piepoli in the middle. And De Luca pushing on, pushing on. He's wanting to get to as much time as possible into his main rivals from behind. He's got a big job on his hands, hasn't he, Danilo De Luca, as is Ricardo Rico. They've got to dispense with three potential team leaders in Astana. They must have taken a huge gulp when they found out that Astana had been invited to the Giro d'Italia after all. That's not what they probably wanted to hear.
No, certainly not. I think it would have, you know, made it a little bit easier for the riders, the other general classement riders in this Tour of Italy without the Astana team. But of course, you know, they've came here in force and with, you know, three potential big stage race winners and proven riders as well. You know, they've all proven themselves in a three-week tour, which is very important. So I think, you know, it wouldn't have been the news they'd been looking for, some of these, especially the Italian riders.
3:35 back to the pink jersey of Visconti from our lead man Bozioso. Look at the amount of effort that's going in. Second win for Danilo De Luca. It's Piepoli who's sitting on his wheel at the moment, then Rico, then Contador. The big question is, what sort of shape is Contador in? Because he wasn't expecting to be riding here. What sort of shape do you keep yourself in, Sean, if you're not sure what race you're going to be riding in at all that year? I mean, he had a very good victory in the Tour of the Basque Country, but I mean, how do you approach things? You just have to keep plugging away and training.
Yes, well, of course, you know, the programme of races wasn't that bad in the beginning of the season, and you know, the Pure de Pays Basque won that, and you know, that is a, you know, a good pointer that this form is quite good. But you know, not having the 3-week tour on the on your programme for a number of weeks, maybe you know, you do not prepare as you should for a 3-week tour. But still, you know, Contador, he's such a talented rider, and I think you know, which, if he gets through this race in the first 10 days, 12 days, he could, you know, get into the rhythm of things, and I certainly think he will be in there in the end.
That's just in, so just to cut you off short there, Sean, but Denis Menchov, the Russian rider, the leader of Rabobank, has decided it's time to now up the gas himself, because at least two of his, well, three major rivals, even possibly four if you count Piepoli, are up the road. Contador here at the back for Astana, De Luca just ahead, then Rico and Piepoli in the yellow and black of Sonia Deval. Rico has already said he wants to win this overall. De Luca wants to retain the title. Contador has won the Tour de France. Denis Menchov, the victor of the Tour of Spain, twice the victor of the Tour of Spain, in fact, and deciding that now this is a little dangerous to let get away. He's had to come to the front and do something himself and push on the pace of the peloton. It's about limiting the gap between these guys. And look, it's whittled down to about 20 riders. That injection of pace. And you can bet your bottom dollar that all the big names, or most of the big names, are in here. Giovanni Visconti's team have been led through by Paolo Bettini. You could see, actually, before the attack of Denis Menchov, Bettini was on the front with Juan Manuel Garate just protecting the pink jersey of Visconti. I think we can say the pink jersey will stay on Visconti's shoulders today, unless Alain Perez or Daniele Nardello or Francesco Gavazzi are in that front group, and I haven't seen any evidence that that's the case.
Well, we haven't seen a lot of that group with Menchov. You know, there's about 20, 25 riders. So it's interesting, you know, to see now who is hanging in there in the classement, because this final, you know, this final run-up, of course, there is going to be a battle there. And certainly it looks like, you know, this rider, Bossioni, is going to hold on out there. These guys, I thought this group of the chasing group of Menchov was a little bit closer. So they, you know, it looks like they're just going to hold on as well and hold this chasing group off.
Well, that's interesting. It'll just see how much, how desperate or concerned people like De Luca and Rico are to get as much time into their rivals as possible. De Luca still pushing on, super aggressive rider. Rico, I've got to say, looks fairly comfortable. There is Gilberto Simoni in the shot. The first time we've seen him in this group, with Andreas Klöden on his wheel. Menchov has slipped back in this group now, as the Dequa Giovanni boys of Gilberto Simoni work their way towards the group of Contador, Piepoli, Rico and De Luca. But this man, Gabriele Bossioso, is going to take victory here today on stage 7 to add to his victory in the Giro d'Oro earlier this year. He won the Tour de Latinum last year, and he also, interestingly, won one of the stages on the test event in Beijing, where they tested the road course last year. So he's one of those riders who can turn in a super performance now and again. Gabriele Bossioso, riding for LPR, De Luca's teammate, has been given the all clear to go and attacked. And Kurienko was the man who hung on to him for as long as possible. Kurienko did a lot of work beforehand, but I've got to say, he's not shirked any work at all, Gabriele Bossioso. Had a very good ride today.
Yes, well, certainly very impressive there. And when he went away on that flat section, Kirievka, it looked like he was going to close him down, but you know, it's it tells us that he was going at a very strong pace, because to hold him off a very good time trial on that sort of terrain, it looked like he would close him down. So it's certainly, you know, a very strong ride, and he hasn't been, you know, hanging about today. He's doing the work the same as everybody else in that breakaway.
That looks like little Emanuele Sella now fighting to try and get back on. There is Vasily Kirienka. I think he's ridden very well as well today. He is in second spot at the moment. I think he's got about 28 seconds back on Bossioso. Looking in good shape, Gabriele Bozioso, well within the last kilometre. Vasily Kirienka about 28 seconds back, and he'll be immensely popular today. This LPR team, Danilo De Luca's team, with 200 metres to go. And all the bikes being funneled off. And we go back to our camera at the end of the straight. Oh, no, we don't. We go and see CSC, Nicky, as Chris Sorensen, I think, he was having a go there. But Gabriele Bozioso today is going to take the biggest victory of his career. Been a professional since 2005, has won the Giro d'Oro this year, and takes victory on stage 7, the first mountaintop finish in the Giro d'Italia. Behind him, Vasily Kirienka. Super ride by Kirienka as well, the Belarusian. Remember, we've seen him a couple of times in the World Championships. He likes to have a good long hard break, and that's a very fighting finish by Emanuele Sella, having been dropped by the big two chaps on the flat. Another great result for Tinkoff, Sean.
Yes, well, certainly, a great result, and Kirienka, a magnificent time trial, but on the hills, and especially, a one like this, an uphill finish, not the cup of tea for him. If it had been a flatter running, he certainly would have been, in with a very good chance. But Bozioso, of course, was the strongest man of the breakaway.
Thank you very much, says Emanuele Sella, offering up a prayer. Third place today, but he's really done great things for his challenge to take the green jersey for best climber. And look at it, the first three places, and it's going to be the first four places as well on this year's stage, are to teams that are not in the UCI Pro Tour. Cardenas comes home to take the fourth place, and the first Pro Tour team are going to be Sonia Deval. And remember, here come the bonuses. They're absolutely vital to the placings. And Danilo De Luca just wanting to put in extra time as much as possible. And Alberto Contador really suffering. Rico is on the wheel of Danilo De Luca. That is very, very telling. Ricardo Rico, the man who we've said talks the big talk, seems to be able to walk the big walk so far. De Luca putting in a final burst and putting extra time into Alberto Contador, not able to hold onto the wheel in that final attack. And this isn't, look at these people in here. Clodin at the front, Joaquin Rodriguez, Denis Menchov, David Rebellin, Franco Pellazzotti, Chris Sorensen, Gilberto Simoni, Sergei Ivanov is in this group, the Russian national champion. And at the moment, it looks like Rebellin who's leading them up the climb here. Rebellin brings the next group home with Pellazzotti in his wheel, and Clodin looking very, very calm and in control behind that. And then a little gap back to Rodriguez and Menchov. It's very, very interesting to see who's got the form and who hasn't at this particular stage, Sean, because Rico was quick as a flash onto the wheel of De Luca when he get that last burst to try and put a good kicking into Alberto Contador, and they both managed it too.
Yes, they certainly did, but Contador, I think, he's come out quite well, immediately went with them, and not losing an awful lot there, and as we get further into this race, I think that's the time we will see maybe Contador maybe not in the rhythm of the race as yet because of the program of race, and not expecting to be here. So I think as the race go on, he should get a bit better and stronger.
And Clodin looking very, very calm. Here is Giovanni Visconti coming up towards the line. He started the day at 1:22 over his nearest rival, Daniele Nardello. We've not seen Nardello come home in the front group. Neither have we seen Mateusz Rus come over in the group. There he is, just coming over there. Yeah, just come over there. But he wasn't in the groups ahead of him. And he certainly hasn't lost out to his nearest rival, Franco Pellazzotti, within the big group. didn't see Matteo Priamo, or certainly didn't see Francesco Gavazzi. We'll have to get confirmation of that, but Gavazzi riding for Lamprey. I guess he could have come in the group just ahead, but I don't think so. I would guess Giovanni Visconti is going to hang on to the pink jersey again today, with Mateus Rus just behind him. Emanuele Sella. Well, this is his big aim, isn't it, Sean, to go for the green jersey?
Yes, of course, and you know, it's something that's very possible for him, and we have seen it before: get into breaks, get up the road in the mountain stages, pick up a lot of points in the earlier part, and it's certainly the way in all the tours, basically Tour of France over the past number of years. It seems the way they win the mountain jersey.
Ozzy takes victory today on stage 7 ahead of Vasily Kirienka from Tinkoff at 46 seconds. Then Emanuele Sella at 102, Cardenas at 133, and Danilo Di Luca closing in at 224. But fine victory for Bozioso. Then going down to 6th place, Riccardo Rico coming in right on the wheel of Danilo Di Luca. Then Piepoli, Alberto Contador was really at full stretch then to try and keep up. Go back further a little more. Andreas Claudin, his teammate at 255. Rodriguez at 255. Then Menchov. Then Brugigin at 255. And Chris Sorensen. Well, we saw Brugigin was one of the riders trying to close up the gap. Well, this is down. This is back down on the flat when we saw Bozioso trying to get away, and he managed to do so. Kirienka when going on to chase him. I think this is probably the point where Emanuele Sella maybe suffered a puncture. And we had something on race radio, thought there was a puncture, but he was certainly on his radio then, calling back to the car. If so, that's a fabulous result for Emanuele Sella, because he will have had to chase exceptionally hard to even consider getting third place.
Yes, well, certainly it would have been, you know, a very vital moment to have a mechanical problem, and you know, to get a wheel change, get back in the rhythm again. It's quite a good ride if he did have a mechanical.
There is Kirienka, replete with plaster on chin from having fallen off the other day. And here is Emanuele Sella, wearing the green jersey for best climber already. Gets even more points for going on to the top of this climb. 15 points for the arrival today. And he also takes 8 seconds of time bonus as well. Let's have a look at the overall standings. In the climbers competition, Sella 36 points ahead of Felix Cardenas, clear 20 points between them now. Then Bozioso takes 15 points from winning today and moves up to third overall, and Kirienka takes 12. Kirienka, in fact, already had 2, so he adds 10 to that. Bozioso, Gabriele Bozioso, victor, it says, stage 7, and he's had a good year so far with the Giro d'Oro victory. Last year he took a stage in the test event they had in Beijing for the road race, and this year, and also won the Tour de Latium. Confirming then that Bozioso is the winner on today's stage, ahead of Kirienka and Emanuele Sella. Terrific victory, but behind, the battle was well and truly raging. And Danilo Di Luca launched a stinging attack, and Riccardo Rico was right on him like a flash. And Contador, I have to say, at first looked as though he was in super shape, because he got onto that little attack by Danilo Di Luca very quickly indeed, but later on beginning to suffer. You think he'll come round?
Well, yes, I think, you know, if you consider the circumstances, there is a good possibility. But again, you just never know, because you know, you're calculating your season, you have your training program on the program race you've got. So I think we just have to wait and see, and you just never know. But I have confidence in him.
Looking down then at the finish today at Pesco Costanzo. They've done 180 kilometres today of hard racing, and all split to pieces at one point. just whittling things down, and that's a fascinating situation with Danilo Di Luca. Really, really big, super aggressive, as he normally is. The one rider we didn't see up at the front, we didn't see Levi Leipheimer. I don't know if you saw him come across. I had no vision of him at all coming across the line.
No, no, I did not, actually. And, you know, there's a number of riders there who you'd be looking out for. But if you look at the times, I think about 51 seconds was the advantage that Di Luca had on that group of Clouden. You know, it's a nice it's a nice number. It's a nice gap to pull out there on a stage, maybe, which is not, you know, the one which is certainly not the most difficult. But the first mountain stage is a good indicator. And Di Luca finishing very strong with Rico. And, you know, to get Contador off the wheel there in that final couple of hundred metres, they have to be really going strong. And you must remember Contador, he never did any riding in that group. It was Di Luca, Rico, Pipioli who was doing all the riding. So you know, if you can keep on that, but it's, you know, it's a long way to Milan.
It's a long way to Milan, but Di Luca will certainly have known, and Rico will have known, that it's the sort of finish that would suit Di Luca, by the very fact that the group was brought up by with Contador in it, had Rebellin at the front, Specialetti just coming over the line, Savoldelli coming over the line, long way down. So Savoldelli definitely in his Super Domestique role, no chance of him being up near the front at the moment. But a good finish for Di Luca, a good finish for a good medium climber who can climb at speed like Rebellin. I think that's possibly what Di Luca thought. I'll just take as much advantage of that as possible. And that's exactly what he did today, putting 51 seconds into Clouden. Well, there's a few people who might be thinking of putting their own memorial up after today. I would think there's quite a few tired legs. That was a very fast finish. I'm very surprised that Di Luca went so hard when he did. Rico, though, looking very strong, straight onto his wheel.
Yes, looking very comfortable. And, of course, Di Luca, we're in his area. This is where he comes from. So he would know this roads very well and maybe, you know, to put up a good show because, you know, he's so close to home here.
Yes, Abruzzo is where Di Luca comes from. He's the first man from the south or the mid of Italy to ever win the Giro d'Italia. He'd love to do it again. Everybody else has come from the north. We'll take a short commercial break. We'll come back for overall standings and the podiums. Well, let's bring you up to date with who is holding the pink jersey then. It is Visconti, still ahead of Mateus Ross, ekes out a 9-second advantage now. Bossioso moves up to third overall, but 5:43 back, and then Sella, and then Danilo Di Luca. Behind him is Riccardo Rico. And Cardenas, of course, sandwiched between the two of them. Rico, Nardello, Contador at 7:56, then Pellazzotti at 8:11 now. That's still going to shake up quite drastically in the coming days. Here is Gabriele Bossioso taking the biggest victory of his career and his second big one for this year, really, the Giro d'Oro, first one, and now a stage in the Giro d'Italia. That's something he'll remember for the rest of his life. It's a rather large bottle of champagne to spray around there, isn't that? In a minute, and you can absolutely guarantee he's going to. It looks rather shy. There's Gabriele. He shouldn't be. He should be very proud of his achievement today. Not an easy finish, and he was out all day in the break and timed his attack very, very well indeed. Got rid of Vasily Kirienka. He's very. He's very careful, isn't he? Well, maybe not. Victory then for Gabriele Bossioso, spraying the champagne for his first victory here in the Giro d'Italia, soaking the podium girls at the same time. Good on him. Tomorrow's stage eight, is into Tivoli from Revisondoli. 208 kilometers tomorrow with just the one climb in the day. Early on, second category climb at Foca di Arco, But the big story today is that Danilo De Luca has made his intentions to not to give up his pink jersey without a fight. Very well known indeed. Launching himself out of the front of the peloton and a stinging attack on some of his big rivals, putting 51 seconds into some of the big ones like Andreas Klöden. But Ricardo Rico looking strong, was there all the time. We'll see you tomorrow. Have a good afternoon. Bye-bye.